On August 8, 1991, Shapur Bakhtiar, a pro-democracy lawyer, a political leader, and the last prime minister of Iran's monarchy, was found dead in his residence in Sorin, a suburb of Paris. Assassins sent from Iran had killed him and his secretary, Sarush Katibe, with kitchen knives 2 days earlier. Shapur Bakhtiar was a man who stood for his beliefs, even when the odds were against him. His life was out of the ordinary, as was his death. Shapur Bakhtiar, the father of four, was born on June 26, 1914, into an influential family of the Bakhtiari tribe. Young Bakhtiar's education began in Shahrekord for primary school and continued in Esfahan and Beirut for high school. His academic pursuits led him to France, where he would later obtain degrees in law, philosophy, and political science, and a PhD in law in 1945. During World War II, Bakhtiar joined the French army in 1940, later becoming part of the resistance against German occupiers. In 1946, Bakhtiar returned to Iran, where he was appointed to head the labor departments in Esfahan and Khuzestan provinces. There, he championed independent union activities, gaining popularity among oil and textile workers, despite facing opposition. As Director General of the Ministry of Labor during Mohammad Mossadegh's premiership, Bakhtiar played a pivotal role in establishing the Workers' Social Security Organization in 1952. Bakhtiar was a social democrat and staunch supporter of a secular democracy. In 1949, he had joined the Iran Party, one of the main groups that formed the pro-Mossadegh National Front coalition. Despite being arrested multiple times after Mossadegh's overthrow in 1953, he continued to advocate for democracy.
جلساتی داشتن که هر هفته من یادم منزل یک نفر بود هفته یه دفعش هم منزل خود ما بود پدرم میدونست که اشکال پیدا خواهد شد و همینم میشد بعد از مدتی دو نفر میامدن در خونه ما خیلی مؤدب مینشستن خونه ما چایی میخوردن پدر منم چمدونش حاضر و میگفتن بفرمایید آقای دکتر شما بازداشت هستید.
In 1977, Bakhtiar co-signed an open letter to the Iranian monarchy, demanding the respect of Iranians' constitutional rights. In 1978, Bakhtiar accepted the role of prime minister in an attempt to prevent the establishment of a religious dictatorship. He released political prisoners, lifted media censorship, and dissolved the political police. He also called on Iranians to form political parties and prepare for elections.
You can write whatever you want about me and criticize me. I will not protest. But do not forget what I told you earlier in this discussion. The sound of the cleric's Nalin mule is more dangerous than the sound of the military's boot. And if the clerics come to power, you yourself will be their first victims.
Many Iranians shared Bakhtiar's apprehension about the cleric's bid for power. Despite the intimidating number of mesmerized and sometimes violent anti-government protesters, thousands dared come out in Tehran in support of the constitution.
من یک برنامه را اجرا کردم که خود آیت الله اینقدر انتظار نداشت در یه مدت به این کوتاهی که شما اشاره کردید. چه از من میخوان؟ هیچ.
Posez tant de questions. Cette question, c'est moi qui vous la pose. Pourquoi ce peuple qui a encore 18 mois chercher, se battre pour avoir un local pour organiser un parti politique. Nous avons fait tout notre possible il y a 6 mois pour avoir un local pour nous réunir au nom du Front National. Pourquoi ces leaders actuellement ne forment pas, ne n'agissent pas exactement dans le cadre constitutionnel pour la formation des partis politiques? Ils préfèrent la rue, ils préfèrent la bagarre et je trouve que cette liberté dont nous avons parlé tout à l'heure n'est pas très appréciée par ces gens.
فقط به فقط مسائلی که جناب عالی فرمودید این کشتار دو روزه به تمام معنا همونطوری که دیروز گفتم گناهش کردن اون مردمی است که تحریک میکنه. چرا؟ چون آزادی نبود، چون مطبوعات آزاد نبود، چون زندانیان سیاسی داشتیم، تظاهرات البته میشد. وقتی که 1 میلیون آدم روز 3 روز پیش از اینجا گذشت خون از دماغ کسی بیرون نیامد ولی 15 نفر دیروز این کار را انجام دادند اینا مأموریت دارن که ایران را به نابودی ببرن. خب میبرن دیگه. ولی من میستم که این کار نشه. اگر که بنا باشه که هر کس در مملکت هر چه خواست بگه، این دموکراسی است. ولی وقتی که هر چه خواست بکنه، این دیگه آنارشیسم هم نیست. هیچ مملکتی قبول نخواهد کرد.
Ayatollah Khomeini, who had no intention to put his mandate to vote, declared his government illegal. Bakhtiar was forced out of office on February 11th after the army declared its neutrality.
دولت اون آدم، مجلس اون آدم، تمام اینها غیر قانونی است و اگر ادامه به این بدن اینها مجرمند و باید محاکمه بشن و ما اونها را محاکمه میکنیم. من دولت تعیین میکنم، من تو دهن این دولت میزنم، من دولت تعیین میکنم، من به پشتیبانی این ملت دولت تعیین میکنم.
He went into hiding for several months before fleeing to France, where he founded the National Movement of the Iranian Resistance, or NAMIR.
No, but your opinion of the state of Iran right now, and your future?
As I have told you, there is no state in Iran. Mr. Bazargan himself are telling you again and again, have told there is no one government, there is a lot of government. One of them are Mr. Bazargan government.
What is your role and the future of Iran?
That is up to the lot of things, I see. I can tell you, I am going to fight as I have fought during 30 years.
مقصود این است. مقصود این است که ما به تکنولوژی غرب نزدیک نشویم. مقصود این است که ما بتوانیم با همان افکار 400 سال غرب در یک دنیا منابع طبیعی خودمون را بدهیم و به هیچ صورت وقتی که این منابع تمام شد جز مشتی فقیر و بیچاره نمانیم.
In 1980, Bakhtiar narrowly survived an assassination attempt orchestrated by a commando sent by Ayatollah Khomeini. The attempt failed, and the assailants who had killed a policeman and Bakhtiar's neighbor were arrested and convicted to life imprisonment with a mandatory 18 years term.
8h45, un commando de 5 terroristes pénètre au 101 boulevard Binot à Neuilly. L'ancien premier ministre du Chahi vit dans l'appartement de sa fille, mais il n'a jamais caché son adresse et seuls 4 policiers protègent l'immeuble. Les terroristes garent leur voiture et trompent la vigilance des gardiens en se faisant passer pour des journalistes.
Ils sont au moins 5, hein.
Ils sont au moins 5.
Dans une femme, hein.
Ils sont arrivés en voiture?
Oui.
Et quel...
Avec équipé naturellement en matériel de journaliste, certainement.
Ils avaient des appareils photo,
oui,
des choses comme
ça. Oui.
Et comment est-ce qu'ils ont essayé d'entrer dans l'immeuble?
Oh, bah, ils ont discuté avec les agents.
The head of Iran's hit team was the Lebanese Anis Nakash. His involvement with armed groups and Ayatollah Khomeini's supporters predates the revolution.
یعنی من از اون طرف آشنا شدم به امام خمینی با فتوای ایشون واجب فلسطین و پولی که جمع شده از بازار تهران برای کمک فلسطینی‌ها و برای مردم جنوب لبنان به عنوان فتوا قابل اجرا از فتوای امام خمینی اون زمان که وقت نجف اشرف بود. و از اون زمان من متوجه شدم که این مسئله عقیدتی نه مسئله مثلا موقت یا فقط سیاسی. 78 وقت اسرائیل به لبنان حمله کردی و یک جزء از لبنان اشغال کردی، آقای رفیق دوست از بازاری های تهرانی اومد بیروت و من از این لحظه اولین بار بهشون آشنا شدم.
Undeterred by the dangers, Bakhtiar continued to promote his ideals of democracy and human rights, and his movement grew.
جمهوری اسلامی را شناختند و در برابرش ایستادگی کردند و بیش از همه از سوی این دستگاه نامردمی آسیب دیدند، به حقوق حق خود یعنی تساوی واقعی مرد و زن خواهند رسید.
In 1990, the commando members were pardoned and exchanged with French hostages in Lebanon. The release had been called for by a group in Lebanon that claimed responsibility for a deadly wave of bombings in public places in Paris from 1985 to 1986.
Une nouvelle fois, l'attentat a visé un lieu public bondé. Il y avait effectivement énormément de monde au moment où tout cela s'est produit.
Oui, écoutez, ce que je peux vous dire, c'est que sur place, nous avons vécu l'horreur. Nous sommes arrivés quelques minutes seulement après que la bombe ait éclaté. J'ai vu personnellement plusieurs personnes très gravement blessées, évacuées. C'était absolument terrible. Alors maintenant, les enquêteurs sont en train de chercher comment tout cela s'est passé.
Less than a year later, in April 1991, Abdurrahman Burumand, Bakhtiar's friend and his Namir's number two, was stabbed to death in the lobby of his apartment building. 3 months later, on August 6th, assassins sent by Iran brutally murdered Shapur Bakhtiar and his secretary, Sourouche Katibeh, in Bakhtiar's heavily protected residence in a suburb of Paris.
Iran's prime minister to the Shah had been stabbed to death at his home outside Paris 2 days earlier, along with his secretary. French police identified three suspects, Faridoun Boyer Ahmadi, Ali Vakili Rad, and Mohamed Azadi.
One of the killers, Ali Vakili Rad, was captured in Switzerland and tried in France.
L'avocat général Mouton a tenu à préciser un point. Ce procès, a-t-il dit, n'est pas un procès politique. Nous ne jugeons pas des prisonniers politiques. Mais avec la même fermeté, au cours de ses 4 heures de réquisitoire, il a mis en cause nommément la République islamique d'Iran et ses services secrets. En reprenant la chronologie de l'affaire, il a voulu démontrer que ce meurtre avait nécessité la mobilisation d'un réseau très organisé dont les trois accusés ne sont qu'une partie.
In 1994, a French court sentenced him to life imprisonment, while Zainul Abidine Sarhadi, the Iranian official sent to Switzerland to exfiltrate the killers, was released and returned to Iran.
Les juges ont condamné Massoud Hamdi à 10 ans de réclusion et en revanche, le troisième accusé, Sarhadi, a été acquitté, ce qui entraîne une polémique.
De Shapur Bakhtiar, comme pour la présidente des SOS Attentats, l'assassinat de l'ancien premier ministre du Shah a été commandité par l'Iran et seule la raison d'État peut expliquer le verdict de ce soir.
Bien sûr que vous allez voir Téhéran ravi et vous allez voir que ce soir à l'ambassade de la République islamique, on va... On va rire à la barre de la justice française, c'est tout ce que je veux dire.
Merci.
Ce soir, l'Iran n'est pas condamné. Seuls les débats ont permis de mettre en cause la responsabilité de l'Iran, mais la décision est là et ça, on ne peut pas la contester.
The trial left many questions unanswered. Why was the security of Bakhtiar so lax after two other dissidents, Sirou Salahi and Bakhtiar's close associate, were killed in Paris? How could the assassins escape so easily, despite Bakhtiar's heavy security protection? Why were the security protocols not respected? Why did the border police release the killers after detaining them for using fake visas? In 2010, Ali Vakili Rad was released in exchange for Clotilde Rice, a French academic accused of spying in Iran. After the disappointment of a court ruling that failed to shed light on Iran's involvement in Shapur Bakhtiar's murder, his family had hoped that France would not pardon their father's killer, as it had done with the niece Nakash.
بعد از سال 1991 که پدرم کشتن، دوباره آزادی وکیلی راد اینن کشته شدن پدرم دوباره است.